for those of you that have ever met me, for those of you that know me, for those of you that I've had conversations with, you're going to know I've got a love with words. I love words, the power of words. Maybe it's because I'm an international speaker. I don't know. Maybe it's because, according to my wife, I love the sound of my own voice. And maybe one or two of you in the audience have said that as well, too. Just saying, I don't know. But I love words. I love words. And there's certain words that just get my attention more than other words. And there's one word that every time I see it, it just leaps off the page. Power. Even just saying that word, doesn't that word just sound like the word power? Just saying that. I love the word power. Now any word can have a negative connotation. Too much of anything can be a negative thing. I get that. But I think power overall has a very positive connotation to some degree. We want power. We want the power to do something. We want to be empowered to be able to see something through or to do something. So when you think of the word power, those are some of the thoughts that kind of go through my mind. And if you do like one of those word association activities, you know, this is a rhetorical question, so you don't have to answer it. But just think, when I say the word power, what thoughts come into your mind? Speaking only for myself, and it's kind of weird up here sometimes, so I'm not going to let you see too much into the inner sanctum. But when I say power, what do I think about? Maybe Arnold Schwarzenegger in his prime. You know, kind of like me. Arnold Schwarzenegger in his prime, right? Kind of. You guys can laugh a little bit once in a while. That's okay. But no, like Arnold Schwarzenegger in his prime. Just this powerful specimen of a human being. Maybe like some kind of a tank. You know, the sheer power of a tank. Rolling over whatever it wants. It's got this armor that just cannot be penetrated. Maybe with respect to power, something smaller like a power tool can cut through anything, can saw through anything. There's no material that can withstand this power tool. Those are some of the words that come into mind for me. And when we talk about that being associated with power, especially if you look at the first two, like a very strong human being physically or a tank, they have the power to break things. They have the power to destroy things. They have the power to ruin things. When you look at power tools to some degree, too, I would say it might be just the opposite. They have the power to build things, the power to create things, the power to construct things from scratch. And I think that shouldn't be lost on us. The other thing that shouldn't be lost on us, too, are probably three words with respect to that association that maybe you don't hear a lot about when you say the word power, like syllables, like words, like sentences. Because what I would argue is just like a strong person has the power to break things, syllables have the power to break things. Maybe more so. Just like a tank has the power to destroy things, words have the power to destroy things. Maybe more so. Just like a power tool has the ability to build things, create things, construct things. Sentences have the ability to build things. And when it comes to power, gosh, I want power. I feel powerless. I don't have power. I want to be empowered. I don't think a lot of people fully realize that we are all endowed with this power to create things, to build things, to destroy things, using nothing more than our syllables, words, and sentences. And I think that's a power that we all have to understand. But the other question is, do we appreciate not only that we have this power, but truly how powerful this can be? I mean, you think about this, and today is no exception. This is why I love C-Suite for Christ so much. It's fun to be here. It's great to enjoy fellowship and everything else. But everybody that gets brought into your life, everybody is carrying a cross. Some crosses are a little bit heavier than others. Every person that you talk to, every person that you interact with has a heaviness to some degree. Some days are heavier than others. Are we appreciating what our words are doing to somebody in that situation? Could you imagine somebody who's having a hard time getting out of bed? Somebody who's barely hanging on. Somebody it's taking every ounce of their courage just to hang on by a thread. And when that person enters our life, unbeknownst to us, we don't know what they're going through. But we make a sarcastic comment that impacts that person. Or we say something in jest that we meant to be a joke that they interpret the wrong way. Or rather than building up, we inadvertently tear them down. That can send somebody in the absolute wrong direction. You must appreciate this power. We all have it. And the choice is ours. And if you think I'm doing this for dramatic effect, I can't tell you. I'm probably understating the importance of this power because it's in the good book. Let's look at the first verse that I want to share with you here. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Guys, this is serious stuff. It's not win or lose. It's not slightly come out ahead or slightly regress. What were the first two words of Proverbs chapter 18? Death, life. This is literally a struggle of life and death. It is life and death hangs in the balance based on the words that we choose, the power of our syllables, the power of our sentences. And the sooner we acknowledge that and the sooner we appreciate just how serious this is and the ramifications of the words we use, the better that's going to be. You may recall last month during the morning inspiration talk that I gave, I talked about how that power to raise people from the dead, how that lives within us, how the power to part the Red Sea, how that lives within us, that power lives within us because Christ lives within us. This is powerful stuff. And these things have dramatic consequences. So it really is, how do we use this power? First of all, you have to recognize it. But then you have the choice of how do you use this. And when you think of all the people that come into your life, you think of all the conversations that you have. How are we going to use this? I hate to even think about this sometimes, but just think about how your day has gone up to this point. What words have you used up to this point today? What sentences have you said? What syllables have you said? And are you regretting using some of those words? Gosh, it's 8:11 Central Time, and some of us have already fallen off the wagon. And that's today. Think about the course of last week. Think about the course of our lives. That list can be awfully big. How are we going to use these words? Now, we're not perfect. I'm certainly not perfect. My goodness, I'm probably the least perfect person in this entire room. I'm the first to admit that. But are we going to use our words to complain? To gossip, to backbite, to put others down, to talk about how wrong our life is and politics this and politics that and she said this. How are we going to use these words? Because we got to be very mindful of this. According to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, here's what this says. To really emphasize this and drill this home. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up as fits these occasions, that it may give grace to those who hear. We are commanded to not have corrupting talk. We are commanded to build people up. We need to be mindful of the fact that our syllables, our words, our sentences are designed to lift people up and be a blessing to others. And in a world like we live in right now, my goodness, just look at, I don't even need to talk about how challenging 2020 is. We know that. But in a world that is busted, in a world that is broken, in a world that political correctness, there's no place for Christ here. You're not skinny enough. You're not wealthy enough. You don't look a certain way. You don't have a certain job title. You're not a size zero. Your job title isn't what it's supposed to be. This world will tell you every single day and twice on Sunday why we're bad, why we're wrong, why we stink. And that weighs on you after a while. So in a world like this, it doesn't necessarily take a magic drug to cure what ails society. It doesn't necessarily take a magician or a special doctor or some individual to wave a magic wand and cure everything. It doesn't take a miracle. There's exceptions to everything, but I would say more often than not, it just takes someone to use the power of their words to encourage, to inspire, to uplift, to offer hope, and to offer love. And the last thing I'm going to say, just so you understand the ramifications of this, it's not just how our words impact this person. There are consequences for us based on the words we use, or to some degree, the words we don't use. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36. I tell you, on the day of judgment, People will give account for every careless word they speak. Let me say that one more time to really emphasize this. Matthew chapter 12, verse 36. I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. Every careless word we speak. We're not perfect. We're going to make mistakes, but let's keep this front of mind. It's too late for us to go back now. It's too late for us to take back those words. It's too late for us to go back and say, I should have, could have, would have said this. Too late. But today, on this Ash Wednesday, as a collection of brothers and sisters in Christ, let's make a commitment today that going forward, we're not going to speak death. We're not going to speak foul. We're not going to put other people down. We're not going to use our words to destroy. Instead, starting today, we're going to speak hope. We're going to speak love, but more importantly, we're going to speak life.